Well, we're on to day three. It's starting to get a little bit samey at this point, or at the very least, the initial shock value is over. So I think I'm just going to start using alcohol to get me through the rest of this. Fuck. Okay, this is a Japanese anime type show, so maybe I should drink some sake. No, it's just beer. Those are hot. Oh, I think I'm gonna leave that over there for now. So day three starts us off with a certain somebody by the name of Ethan's final day of Gabriel dropout before we move on to something else. So where to even begin with the first episode of today, which is the third episode of Gabriel dropout. I just realized I'm wearing glasses. Oh, you guys are gonna get screen glare and it's gonna get super fucking annoying. Oh well. So, the episode begins with our good buddy. I'll look like that intelligent guy from all the animes. Just like. Okay, so the episode begins with a barista who works at a coffee shop who has recently employed Gabe. Now, Gabe is doing this job pretty poorly. She does her best to make everything work out by being an absolutely awful worker. This ultimately results in his, the Mr. Employer being a very nice, genuine individual and saying, oh, she's probably a foreigner. Which I guess blonde hair is really that. So she continues to be an absolute pain in the ass, being an absolutely awful worker. And this leads to some funny gags, specifically the barista, because he's just such a sweet, honest guy, and she is just such a clod. It creates a lot of fun. So we move on to the all-Christian version of the Angel Tribe. That would be the girl with the silver-purple hair? So she runs into the best friend, who's also a devil, and they pretty much go off to have some lunch. And that's its own funny little element. I noticed, however, at this part that there is a running theme in this show where they try to destroy your expectations but don't really make a joke out of it. So they set up a punchline for a joke that they had this little competition between three cream puffs. One of them's strawberry, one of them's some other flavor, and the other is super stupid spicy. And whoever gets the super stupid spicy one has to pay the bill. Now, the joke would in theory be whoever gets the super stupid spicy cream puff would be like, ha, I'm not gonna get the super stupid spicy puff. I believe in my gut. And then it's the super stupid spicy puff, which wouldn't be funny. It'd be an obvious joke. But that's the moment in which the show would subvert your expectations by doing something totally different with it. The thing is, they don't do anything different with the subversion. They both eat the other two puffs. Satanya walks by in the background, and they give her the cream puff, but we already know that she's taste deaf. So she just eats the food, and she's like, oh, that was good. And then she's like, oh, man, darn. And that's really it. Like, there's no joke to be had. I know the joke is that Satanya's taste deaf, but that's not funny. We already went through that. I think. I don't even know how you would make this joke funny. It kind of sets itself up to fail because it's either a really obvious punchline, which you can go for. You can go for the obvious punchline. Sometimes even Gintamia goes for the obvious punches. But other times, they might as well just like subvert the shit out of it and just do something completely different from the cream puffs. So we cut to yet another part of the episode in which Zaytanya is walking up to the barista coffee shop from the beginning of the episode. She runs into, of course, Gab working. And Gab does probably the funniest joke in the episode by covering her mouth, slamming a fist into her chest, and throwing her out the door. It's such an utterly ridiculous moment. It kind of just caught me off guard. It doesn't make, like, why is she all of a sudden so violent? But of course, it's because she just doesn't want to serve Zaytanya, because Zaytanya would be like, ugh, ooh, kek, kek, kek. think Satania is just the master of making silly faces in the background. That's pretty much all she does in 95% of her cameos. So rudeness aside, both her and Satania pretty much just shit all over the coffee man's coffee. Intermixed between that is a lot of comedy mixed with she's trying to throw a shitload of sugar into the coffee, trying to drop it in her face. Just a fucking Gab's faces that she makes that is really funny. Coffee man gets shot with a bunch of laser beams because no one likes the coffee. It's pretty good. But then Barista man at the very end of the episode, nearly, he runs into Gab's best friend, who happens to really like the coffee and appreciates coffee for what it is, because that was not an obvious joke. Yet again, Gabriel Dropout has a lot of obvious jokes. Maybe it's just me, but it's like they try to subvert while being obvious with how they subvert it. I don't know. Anyway, final part of the episode, Gab's air conditioning breaks, so she basically has to go over to her best friend's house, and that's pretty much all that really happens. There's a couple gags that get thrown along with that, particularly what I actually think is the best gag of the episode, I lied about the other one, is Satania trying to come up to bother Gab, and she just gets fucking obliterated, has the door fall on top of her, and she's there for hours as Gab just goes over her friend's house, just fucking leaves. Satania's dead. She's done for, and that's the episode. So what can I say about Gabriel Dropout? Well, I kind of think it's good that we're getting a break from it right now. I don't think it's very easy to comment about what happens in these comedy shows for an extended period of time. See, with a show like ReZero, you can just, like, go plot to plot. You can go plot to plot, and it makes more sense. With Gabriel Dropout, it's like, oh, that joke was funny. Oh, that joke was funny, too, so needs to be a little bit more spice to the mix, if you know what I mean. Anyway, let's move on to the second episode, which, surprisingly, is not Tokyo Tribe. I know, right? Now, today, we are going to talk about Keijo. Second. Oh, boy. Well, what can I say about Keijo? Well, if you thought I wasn't going to give you the clothes-ripping image from last time, don't worry, they showed it again, and I felt I was obligated to show it to you this time. Oh, great. So, in this episode, it's not as character-driven as the last episode where we got to see all the characters interacting. Instead, it's yet another training episode between the main girl, who is pretty much developing what is known as the vacuum force cannon, something like that. It apparently causes a lot of strain on her body, typical shonen nonsense. So the teacher's like, no, you can't come to this school if you use that technique. To which she replies, fuck you, I'm gonna learn it. And then they're like, fine, take this suit from Mobile Suit Gundam and suck it up. So she does. It's a really skin-tight, super awkward suit. And that's pretty much what she does throughout the whole episode. Best friend throughout the entire episode has her own moral dilemma, because there's this cat girl that appears who literally has cat ears. She's not, like, portraying a cat, she just, her hair naturally points, which is extra weird. And this cat girl can ram her butt very fast, so best friend girl was like, oh, now I need to learn how to do that, because apparently there's three styles of fighting, despite the fact that people are on the island solo, so wouldn't they want to learn all the styles? So there's in stage, off stage, and technical, I don't fucking remember. Basically, one is very physical, counter is the other type, I think. Don't question me on that. So she's an off stager, because they use their ass more than their boobs, I think. I don't fucking know. I don't think it matters. So, pretty much that's the whole episode. I don't think there's really much more to say than that. There's this hilarious camera angle when main girl is trying to describe to the siren, be like, hey, no, I want to use the special move, where all of a sudden the camera just pans sideways, and I have no idea why this happens, and it made me crack up laughing. I was watching this with Zuper, and we were both like, wait, what the fuck? Look at this. Why? Who turned it 90 degrees, and for what reason? What aesthetic or plot-relevant point does this have? What artistic merit is it being panned sideways? I half expect the characters to start sliding into the tables and falling over top of it. Unfortunately, that would only happen in a funny show like Pop Team Epic. And that's kind of my major problem with this show. Zuper finds this show funny, and more power to him. I don't. I find some jokes to be funny, which, by nature of a comedy, I'm probably going to find some of the jokes funny unless it's absolutely horrendous. But it just doesn't work. This is a show that should really just be a very balanced mix of comedy and action, but it isn't. It's just not funny. It's too often just so focused on sexualizing the characters, and it's not humorous. Some of the times it's humorous. When they're walking on their butts, that's funny. When she's wearing this skin-tight suit that looks like something out of a fucking mecha anime, that's funny. But other times, when they just pan to the bathhouse and everyone's just nude for the sake of being nude, there's a bunch of like, ooh, you got big blues. I'm just like, no, it's not funny. It's just, it's lowbrow. It's boring. And that's unfortunately like a major problem. Like, when the characters actually have dialogue, they're funny. Like, she's wearing this suit, and the character's just like, you look stupid. And yeah, she does. She looks absolutely fucking ridiculous. She has to sleep in this. She has to, like, bathe in it, eat in it. She has to do all this annoying shit that she can't do. That's entertaining, but there's not enough jokes to make it worthwhile. And that's the problem with it. There's too many shots where it's just so utterly, utterly boring. So the episode ends, really. They get on the islands. They're going to start this race thing. Something to decide between whether the newcomers and, like, the elite class who gets in. Because it's, like, three normals versus the elite class. Or at least they're on a free-for-all, and that's the specifications. I don't know. All I know is, it's going to be interesting seeing what happens next episode, because I find that the episode that has the majority of them actually participating in the sport to be the entertaining episodes, when it's not just overly sexualized nonsense and it's sexualized for the point of comedy and action, then it's cool. I'm fine with that, for the most part. Other times it's just, no, stop. But we'll see what happens. I'm just going to get to the part where they have the fucking stands, and hopefully Zuper will suggest something a little more tasteful. Speaking of tasteful. Okay, time for three. Oh, and take a guess who this is going to be. Jaden's. You know, the typical ender of the tradition, although I guess not really, because in day one we had Ian's because it was a surprise. Day two was going to be Jaden's. I kind of just figured that Jaden was going to have the final episode every single time because the show's so fucking insane. But no, we're actually ending with Ian's episode today. So until we get there, let's look at Jaden's episode, ReZero episode 16. So we've reset back from the absolute shit show that was last episode. His fucking head popping off. Beetlejuice's nonsense. And we've arrived back with our good buddy Subaru and Ren, as he is currently escaped the passions of disbelief and absolute shitbag lunacy, and has evolved into utter edgelord rage. And that's pretty much the majority of the episode, is him trying to work out his edgelord angst and get a bunch of the townsfolk to be like, hey, guys, yeah, we're about to be pile-drived by the cult, so why don't we all work together and stop the cult from being shitbags? I should also mention it has come to my attention that apparently Amelia is not the witch. So now I'm just even more confused, because I still don't know who the witch is. At this point, it could be Beetlejuice for all I fucking know. Hell, maybe it's Rem. Or maybe it is Amelia and he's just fucking with me. I don't know. So, it starts off with Subaru trying to convince Greenhair to go collect a military front in order to save the townsfolk, which for some reason I guess would be explained in earlier episodes. She both refuses and sees this as an opportunity to scold him like a schoolchild, which I guess he is. Subaru does act very immature in this episode, but it's in such a way where it's kind of endearing, because I feel really, really bad for Subaru. I don't feel like he's whiny to the point of being annoying. He's whiny to the point of being, yeah, no, seriously, get the fucking guards. But she pretty much does not listen to him. She makes this mention that he starts going very ballistic in the middle of this discussion. And she mentions that never once does he mention the word Amelia, so she knows that he's lying or something. So it's like he's trying to convince them to take action against the cult, and she believes that it's him trying to take action specifically against the cult. Which, yes, that is what he is doing. He's taking action against the cult. Yes, his goal is to save Amelia, and that's what he's mentioned in the past, his goal to save Amelia. But the cult comes first. Stopping the cult from slaughtering hundreds of people is probably your main priority. So he gets down, grovels, begs. He's like, please, for the love of your unmovable force, just pull out the guards. And she's like, no, because you're lying. But then she's like, but I do believe you. It's just that you never said Amelia, so I'm not going to help you. She's basically being a complete cunt and throwing around her power like it's nobody's business. And this just rages the Subaru demons. And he walks the fuck out of that room. He bites his lip. This happens a couple times in the episodes and causes blood. Those are some very spiky teeth. I don't even know how hard you have to bite and be like, ah! Like, you have to try pretty fucking hard. He's like tearing his jaw, biting into his mouth. Anyway, he leaves. Every single time he pushes open the door, he has to like curve slight ways, so he like pushes it with his weight. Anyway, so we cut to yet another character who I've never met before. This is some femdom domineering bitch who Subaru later mentions he's saved before. So I'm guessing that this character has appeared in the past, of course, that would make the most sense, but this character was someone that Subaru saved. I'm not sure if that was true or a over-exaggeration. Anyway, Femdom Bitch is like, so you want my help, huh? Well, tell you what, I could kill you right now, but I won't. Anyway, I'll do your proposal if you lick my foot. Stop me now, because I am pretty mad. I'm pretty mad at this lady. She's not a very nice individual to do this to our poor Subaru, who's simply trying to help the fucking townsfolk. Anyway, he thinks about it. He's like, you know what? To save Amelia, to save the town, fuck you. I will lick your goddamn foot, you ugly bitch. So he gets down to do it. She punts him across the room, calls him insignificant, trash, a pig, and says, get the fuck out of my courtroom before I chop your head off. Now, I consider myself a very reasonable person. But when you make a character this unlikable. Oh! Ooh! I do not like this character one bit. What a bitch. What a whore. So, oh god, just looking at some of these angles that she's... Look at her. Anyway, she punches him so hard, he goes flying across the fucking room. Like, this isn't just, like, a couple pieces. No, this is an enormous carpet. He goes sliding like it's a fucking funhouse. It's pretty great. Anyway, this guard comes out. He's like, hey, bro, I'm just going to take you outside. Jaden has informed me that it is a popular theory that this guy is also from Japan and Subaru's world. I don't know if I believe that, giving the little information I know, but sure, whatever. Seems like a pretty nice gent. Oh, yeah. So Subaru goes shoving through crowds, and then, miracle of miracles, we run into something wholesome, is what I said. We run into the cat girl from the intro. You know, the one I'm like, ooh, does that ever happen in the show? And like, probably not. No, she's right there. She even has the cat face, cat ears, little balls hanging from her coat. Like, this thing is adorable. I'm like, yes, I want to protect. And then the other girl appears too. You know, the one with the snow hat. I'm like, hooray! Characters that look wholesome. Maybe they'll go have like a nice meal. Subaru will calm down, learn friendship, and they kind of go do that. Unfortunately, this quickly devolves into political commentary as Subaru tries to ask this lady, hey, could I get some carriages or some shit like that? And she's like, what are you going to give me for it? Oh, what kind of information do you got? So he just gets strung along in this whole information debate. She's yet again another bitch. Except this is one of those, like, smiley bitches. Like, you know, the one that will never stop smiling or anything. And then she's like, ha, you should know everything about the conversation before you jump into it. Anyway, let's go, guys. So she gets up, and then there's a fuckload of guards in the background. This is actually kind of cool, because you could see them wandering around in the background as the scene was transpiring. I'm like, oh, that's actually really cool. Doesn't change the fact that, yet again, the entire world likes to take a dump on Subaru at every possible moment. Oh, so then you think, oh, can the torture please be over? Subaru's just like, fuck it, I'm gonna go towards the castle. If I die, I die. Fuck it, let's just get Amelia out of there. Get as many townsfolk out of there as possible. Because the entire world hates me. He comes across the guy from episode 14. Like, you know, the guy who I said looked like Super's OC but wasn't Super's OC? That guy has a merry band full of merchants. And they mentioned that they have a current problem with getting rid of oil. And Subaru's like, fuck you. I will buy all that oil off your hands if you merchants will start trafficking people. Not slaves, the people in the town next to us, of course. And they're like, sure, fuck it, why not? So they do. And then this really odd scene happens. So they talk about the map, and like, oh, we need to go to this next area. So Subaru is like, oh, here, let me help you. Let me pull out some light. He pulls out his cell phone, and Rem's like, what the fuck is that? Everyone's like, what the fuck is that? And he's like, ah, don't worry about it. Future, ancient, stupid technology. Which is not wrong. The guy next to him is like, that's a really weird light crystal, or something like that. He's like, yeah, I know. Then they come across this giant-ass tree. Wherever that is. Yeah, there's a giant-ass tree. I'm like, well, that's a pretty cool tree, right? Hey, where's that guy next to us? What guy? There was never any guy next to us. You know, the guy was asking me about the light in my cell phone. I was like, who the fuck are you talking about? So Subaru's just like, oh, I guess that's the time of the episode, huh? Oh, yeah, it's that time of the episode. There's a giant fucking eyeball demon right next to me. That's cool. Episode ends. Great. 10 out of fucking 10, as per usual, from ReZero, good ender. I'm honestly curious to see what's going to happen next. Ugh. But now, Tokyo Tribe 2. So if you thought ReZero was insane, hoo boy, today's episode of ReZero was something else. Or, not ReZero. Tokyo Tribe was something else. So, the episode starts in a very odd fashion, yet again at some love club, and it starts with the two characters from the last episode. Specifically, it starts with, Actually, before it gets to those two characters, it starts with this random guy who is walking in the elevator to this club. He gets a fucking gun pointed at him, and that's pretty great. We cut to the big binky-looking guy from the other last episode. He's sitting there typing on his phone, trying to gauge his intelligence or something like that. Some girl comes up, I think, is like asking him, oh, do you want to do anything? But he doesn't. This girl looks like she's in fucking high school, so I'm not even going to touch that. But that's okay, because the guy who has the gun pointed at his head goes up to the door in which his master is at. And then this is the master from the last episode, the womanizer. They're having sex with some random unmentioned lady. So then the gunshot happens, and this guy, right immediately after having sex, runs up to the door, grabs one of the guys who was holding the gun, stabs him repeatedly, bursts out with a knife, and then just all hell just starts breaking loose. He starts torturing the guy, like one of the kidnappers, a lot of blood, a lot of violence. And then we just cut back to the main guy, who is still kind of in a shit show position after the head leader, I think his name was Maki or something like that, was killed last episode. However, we do see the other two youngins come in, start trying to cheer him up, pretty much have themselves a good old time. This is just a really wholesome experience, honestly. Probably one of the most wholesome experiences since Gabriel Dropout about 20 minutes ago. Oh, but one of the guys that was getting chased by Binky started chasing one of the guys, I should mention, by car or something like that. He actually gets into a car accident, and that's great. But then we cut yet again to the Yakuza members, and we find out that the Yakuza sword dude also knows Yakuza pretty boy dude, who I'm just going to call Yakuza pretty boy and Yakuza sword. Because I'm really good with names, let me tell you. Watching four anime at once, I'm not going to get this shit. So Yakuza pretty boy. I think he's the son of Goosh Goosh. I could be completely wrong. I think that is their relation. Anyway. So, on top of that, we do see our main hero go to the car crash site. Because I think the car crash victim that I mentioned earlier was part of their gang. But then Binky comes and grabs him from behind, but that's okay, because main guy's chubby friend comes in with the bat, smacks him with it, and then it just all shit just goes wild. Yet another chase sequence happens. But before that, we gotta cut back to the fucking bar in which we have Pretty Boy having his own interaction with Swordman. It's very obvious they don't like each other. Yakuza Swordman, we learn, had his parents murdered by Goosh Goosh Man, and Goosh Goosh Man's child, who is also Pretty Boy Yakuza Pretty Boy, is just a complete shitlord. And that's that scene. And then we cut back to Binky and the main guy having another bat swinging contest. They chase each other on top of a fucking dump truck. They get into a trash compactor. Binky just continues to fight, takes bat after bat, breaks it into pieces. He snaps the thing into like a little, I don't even know, he just rips it like it's a pipe. Smash. So he gets smashed by a fucking trash compactor. He's fine, don't worry about it. Yeah, that's great. They climb up the trash compactor, he leaves, Womb Man fucking over here, Binky, smashes through the wall. All of a sudden, his arms are metallic and create static electricity. And he mentions that a pretty boy, I believe, gave him these arms. Which is really weird, because you see in scenes before this, his arms are perfectly normal. All of a sudden, they're metallic and glove-like. Are they gloves? Or has all the skin been ripped off them, revealing the metallic underside? I don't know. This guy is enormous. He smashes through a concrete wall, several of them, in order to get to main guy. So that just happens. we cut back to one of the funniest jokes in the episode, as well as one of the funniest jokes out of any of the episodes I've seen all day, in which Sword Guy is like, I took a very narrow path getting here. Cuts to his monster truck. He's right there, and explosions just start blasting in the background as a desolate city road from which he, it's just like, why did you do, he ran over a fucking building's wall. And then they go up an elevator, go into like this bank vault area, and they lock the sword dude in the bank vault. Skunk, the little guy who was holding the sword, the little short dude who is always with Sword Yakuza, he's forced to make a decision of whether to keep his life or start following Pretty Boy Shitlord. So he starts following Pretty Boy Shitlord, and Sword Yakuza has to deal with some goons with assault rifles. He pulls out his fucking katana blade, and the episode pretty much ends. I think that because the main guy and Binky end in the subway where they crash through from the trash yard, the situation is going to be that Pretty Boy on the subway is going to probably crash into the Binky. What the fuck? Talk about an absolutely insane show. There's so much going on at once. It's so hard to keep track of, but at the same time you want to, because it's so awesome. What a manly show. What an absolutely awesome show. This is what you guys should be living up to when you suggest anime. I know you're trying to fuck with me, but this show is fucking with me in a good way. Ugh. So that's day three. What do I even say? Yeah, the theme is still fucking with Ross, I'll tell you that much. That is the last of Gabriel Dropout. Keijo is coming to a close soon. I think Stand Girl comes in episode 5. I'm still going to be watching Tokyo Tribe, because Anne hasn't said anything, so much to my happiness. More Tokyo Tribe for me. But yeah, when we come back tomorrow for more of this, oh boy, we have a lot to come back to. We got this train sequence. We have, oh my god, we have fucking Subaru and the giant eye demon, who's probably just gonna kill him and reset everything. We have a new show from Ethan and Keijo. We got that race, so a lot of exciting things are happening today. Ooh, if you like the episode, good. See you guys for tomorrow. I'm actually pretty excited for once. I should probably take out my glasses before I do the next episode so I don't look this absolutely ridiculous.